Em 2005, quando God of War chegou às lojas, a Sony se preparava para estrear em um importante segmento na indústria de games, o de consoles portáteis. Naquele ano, a fabricante lançou o PlayStation Portátil, mais conhecido pela sigla PSP. A fabricante japonesa tinha como objetivo destronar ninguém menos do que a Nintendo, que sempre dominou de forma absoluta essa parte do mercado. Para encarar essa briga, o PSP buscou aliar portabilidade a um alto potencial gráfico, e God of War, que surpreendeu todo mundo justamente nos quesitos técnicos, era um candidato natural a conduzir este desafio. No terceiro episódio do especial God of War, a criação de um mito, chegou a hora de contar como foram feitos os dois títulos da franquia para o PSP. God of War Chains of Olympus e God of War Ghost of Sparta. Vamos mostrar como a dupla de games que surgiu para complementar a história de Kratos acabou entregando, em um console portátil, uma experiência tão boa quanto a dos games originais. A ideia de produzir um God of War para o PSP começou pouco tempo depois que o primeiro game foi lançado, lá em 2005. Apesar do envolvimento da Sony Santa Mônica, quem deu a ideia de levar o espartano ao portátil foi outro estúdio, a Ready at Dawn. A história de ambos os estúdios era bem parecida. Assim como a Sony Santa Mônica, a Ready at Dawn tinha pouco tempo de existência e estava para colocar seu primeiro game no currículo quando começou a se envolver com o universo de Kratos. Com passagens pela Blizzard e pela Naughty Dog, os integrantes da Ready at Dawn estavam terminando o derivado Dexter, de Jak and Daxter, quando venderam a ideia de um God of War para o PSP. Ru Uerasuriya, desenvolvedor de StarCraft e um dos cofundadores do estúdio, seria o diretor do projeto.
As we're finishing Daxter, I think the automatic idea behind, you know, making the first Daxter was Daxter 2. There's always more to tell. As we're finishing the game, we were in a mode where we were playing a lot of games that were coming out at the time. God of War 1 had just come out. We had all played it. And we were just like in awe of what they had done. We loved it so much that we decided, I know that this might be a little bit tricky to do this, but let's go to Santa Monica and tell them that we want to make a God of War game. Yeah, at the time, Shannon and David were the main points of contact. We went and pitched kind of like, you know, the idea of making that game. We sat down, we had our first kind of powwow, and we brought ideas to the table basically that first day. Their feeling walking in, and I still remember David, the first thing that he actually wanted to talk about was, yeah, great, we'll make a God of War game, so we'll make a 2D platformer side-scroller, you know. And it's kind of that reaction where you kind of step back and you're like, oh, no, 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 what we wanted was to make a God of War game on PSP, like a true God of War game. And in the beginning, it was kind of a question of like making them understand that the PSP is capable of it. The more we talked about it, they were like, you know, David just said, fine, if you guys think we can do it, let's do it. Let's do exactly that. Let's make a true God of War game on PSP.
Assim como aconteceu com a Sony Santa Mônica, o motor gráfico de Dexter, o primeiro game da Ready at Dawn, seria utilizado para a criação do God of War portátil. Além dos desafios técnicos, uma preocupação primordial era encaixar a trama deste jogo em um universo que, embora fosse muito rico, ainda estava em processo de formação. O que nenhuma das partes envolvidas queria era criar o que se fazia normalmente nos portáteis, um simples derivado desligado dos games principais da franquia. Corey Barlog, o diretor do segundo God of War, foi uma das principais pontes nessa colaboração, especialmente em como os jogos se ligam. Enquanto a Sony Santa Mônica se encarregaria de contar a história principal de Kratos, os jogos de PSP seriam responsáveis por expandir o universo e o passado do personagem, aproveitando os intervalos entre os games principais.
God of War Chains of Olympus takes place before the events of God of War, the original God of War, and it's going to tie in a lot into the storyline of God of War, the first one and the second one, and you're going to find out a lot of things actually through the story that you already have seen and played through the other two games.
Um bom exemplo dessa conexão é Atlas, o titã condenado a carregar o mundo nas costas. Quando o Atlas recebeu Kratos com pouco entusiasmo em God of War 2, ficou evidente que ambos os personagens já tinham um passado. Isso acabou sendo explorado em God of War Chains of Olympus, onde o Titã é um dos principais motores da trama, que também envolve a rainha do submundo Perséfone e Morfeu, o deus dos sonhos. Porém, garantir essa sintonia entre a trama dos jogos do PSP e do PS2 nem sempre foi fácil. Na época, a Sony Santa Mônica estava ocupada com a produção de God of War 2, que começou pouco tempo depois do lançamento do primeiro game. Embora houvesse uma comunicação entre os dois estúdios, no fundo, cada um tentava fazer o melhor que podia em seus projetos.
Understand that he was thinking bigger than just the game. We didn't want to go there because there was not enough yet said about Kratos and making people understand who he was. And Corey was telling us where the story was going, so we wanted to make sure that every part of what we were doing would have impacts on the story that was already there and the next one. We made a lot of mistakes. I mean, they also let us make a lot of mistakes for the same reasons, to learn. We thought that we could change things that normally, now we know, we should have never even questioned.
What kind of stuff?
Just about Kratos, about the way he moves and all that stuff. There's a Bible behind how he is and who he is. Mm-hmm. And that Bible at the beginning, I think, wasn't communicated for a couple of reasons. I think the main reason also is that they were so busy with God of War 2. But by the time we had made the mistakes, we had understood, oh, don't do all of that stuff. So we spent the first year just making a lot of mistakes and scrambling to like basically make up for time. And we really did the full God of War game in the last 10 months. We really made that first Chains of Olympus.
Após o lançamento de Chains of Olympus, a Ready at Dawn conseguiu provar para a Sony Santa Mônica e também para o mercado que era possível fazer um jogo do porte de God of War no PSP. A ideia de produzir o segundo jogo, God of War Ghost of Sparta, veio logo após o lançamento do primeiro. E o Erasuria deixou o posto de diretor para Dana Jen, que foi chefe de level design de Chains of Olympus.
When I was doing Chains of Olympus, it almost was a natural transition for Dana to do what he did. I actually asked him before we finished Chains of Olympus. As much as, yeah, it would have been cool to do a second one, I asked him one day, hey, do you want to direct the second one?
Chains of Olympus really gave us the chance to have a lot of people basically prove themselves and step up. I had a guy actually out of Blizzard after he quit from the World of Warcraft team. I hired him as an environment artist on Daxter first, and then he basically became like the lead level guy for Chains of Olympus. Then Dana, who's now game director, is the guy who basically stepped up and became the director of Ghost of Sparta.
You chose your path. Ghost of Sparta.
O sucesso na produção de Chains of Olympus também aproximou a Ready at Dawn da Sony Santa Mônica. A relação de confiança entre os dois estúdios aumentou e isso permitiu que a história do segundo game para PSP tivesse ainda mais impacto dentro da vida de Kratos, com uma rara oportunidade de mostrar o lado mais humano do personagem. O roteiro de Ghost of Sparta, que explora a relação entre o espartano e seu irmão perdido, Deimos, seria originalmente usado em God of War 3.
A história que eu escrevi para 3 inicialmente foi sobre Deimos e Kratos, e depois Stig took over and kind of made it his own. And then I was like, cool, if you're not using Deimos, I'm going to write the Ghost of Sparta script and I'll make that about Kratos and Deimos, which is great because it made it more personal. To me, I'm very proud of the Ghost of Sparta script because that...
Para Ready at Dawn, o fato de ter conseguido terminar Chains of Olympus em tão pouco tempo e com tanta competência, deu ao estúdio as ferramentas e o conhecimento necessários para levar o PSP ao limite em seu segundo game com o Spartan. Enquanto o primeiro jogo tinha como principal desafio replicar a experiência dos jogos de PS2 no portátil, o segundo conseguiu ampliar a mitologia do espartano em todos os sentidos. Um dos maiores exemplos é o gameplay. Enquanto Chains of Olympus mantém a tradicional combinação das Lâminas do Caos com outros artefatos mágicos, Ghost of Sparta vai além e se arrisca a dar a Kratos uma arma secundária completamente diferente: o escudo e a lança tradicionais do exército espartano.
I guess touching on kind of what you were asking just a second ago, one of the weapons that we kind of already put out there that people have been, you know, seeing and you played with, I guess, at E3 probably as well, is the Arms of Sparta, which is a spear and shield combination. And that actually comes from just, you know, classic, you know, visuals that we see Spartan warriors, you know, wielding. We took a different approach with the secondary weapon in Chains of Olympus because we just wanted to do something different and actually really change up the play style. I think the same is true with this weapon, the spear and shield combination we have in Ghost of Sparta, because I think we realized it's not a good idea to try to outdo the blades. The blades are just awesome. Everybody loves them. They play great. You can do cool stuff with them. They're always going to be good.
the thing to do is to maybe go, what else could Kratos use that's also useful, that doesn't compete with that, that maybe complements it or allows you to play in a different way? So we started looking at defense, you know, and it's like this thing where it's like, it's not really fun maybe for the average gamer to play defensively, right? Like, I don't want to be sitting there, hunkering down, just blocking all day. I want to be out there mashing buttons and killing guys and just wrecking fools. So we took defense and turned it into kind of an offense. Like, so he's got this shield and you can do, you know, offensive things with it. You can move while you're blocking, you can gain ground on guys, you can just bash the crap out of them, you can launch them in the air with it. So we took things that we know and we love that work on the blades and we said, how can we, you know, use those mechanics and infuse them into this weapon with new moves and kind of take a different take on it.
Outra grande oportunidade que a Red Hat Dawn aproveitou com Ghost of Sparta foi retratar o destino da mítica cidade de Atlântida. Na mitologia do game, descobrimos que na verdade Kratos foi o responsável por colocar o local no fundo do mar.
I mean, we kind of looked into some of the ways that people had thought, you know, Atlantis had sunk. We were like, where could it possibly be? We looked at locations. We actually looked at some of the work that had been done previously for God of War on Atlantis. Like, apparently Atlantis was a place that was slated to be in, what is it, one two, or two games? Two games two. Now.
No, in God of War 2. God of War
oh, 2. Just in God of War 2, okay, in God of War 2 even. And there was some fantastic concept art that was done for that game. And we were like, oh, they had already some ideas. So we looked into all that, we kind of factored that in. And then we started having a little bit of fun with it, as God of War seems to do with everything. We were like, well, you know, if there's a city of Atlantis, what better way for it to disappear than, you know, having your main character be responsible for the end of it.
Ambos os jogos de God of War para o PSP foram bem recebidos pelo público e pela crítica, que destacou a capacidade de colocar uma aventura tão grandiosa em um sistema portátil. Chains of Olympus, que saiu em 4 de março de 2008, se beneficiou mais dessa boa impressão, especialmente por ter sido o primeiro game a chegar na plataforma. Embora Ghost of Sparta seja maior e melhor em todos os aspectos, o timing pesou contra seus resultados. O game chegou em 2 de novembro de 2010, 8 meses depois do lançamento de God of War 3. Apesar dos elogios, Ghost of Sparta sofreu com as inevitáveis comparações ao game do PS3, que havia acabado de dar um desfecho para a saga de Kratos. Mas, no fim das contas, a grande vencedora foi a própria Red Hat Dawn. O trabalho com os dois God of War fez o estúdio se tornar referência no desenvolvimento de jogos para o PSP e credenciou seus integrantes a evoluir dentro da estrutura da Sony, ganhando a oportunidade de produzir um título de alto orçamento nos primeiros anos da vida do PlayStation 4.
Son has returned. I will have my revenge.
No próximo episódio do especial God of War, a criação de um mito, chegamos a uma nova geração de consoles para contar a história de produção de God of War 3, o apoteótico final da história de Kratos no mundo grego. Vamos acompanhar como foi criado o embate final entre o espartano e os deuses do Olimpo e a luta para produzir um dos jogos mais impressionantes do PlayStation 3.